بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد. So carrying on with the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that we've been discussing in the previous sessions, we got to the section where we discussed the death of the mother of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the fact that his grandfather Abdul Muttalib looked after him after that. And then the poet mentions, or the author mentions, ثم أبو طالب العم كفل خدمته ثم إلى الشام رحل, that it was Abu Talib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who then looked after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam after his grandfather Abdul Muttalib passed away. ذلك أن جده عبد المطلب عندما حضرته الوفاة أوصى بكفالته إلى عمه أبي طالب. And that is because when عبد المطلب was on his deathbed, he counseled and advised for Abu Talib to then look after the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وهو الأخ الشقيق لوالده عبد الله. And Abu Talib is the blood brother of the father of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, عبد الله. وكان معروفا باهتمامه وعنايته بالنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام. And he was known for looking after the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم with care, looking after him with a great deal of care. And then the author mentions regarding the trip that Abu Talib took the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam on to Sham. And that was because at the time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was young, and Abu Talib did not want to leave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam alone back in Mecca. So he decided to take him with him so he could ensure that he is looking after him at all times. He didn't want to have to leave him behind in Mecca under the guardianship of anybody else. And this showed the level of importance Abu Talib gave to looking after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. وذاك بعد عام 12 من مولده. And that was after 12 years. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was now beyond that age of 12 years onwards when this trip occurred to the land of Sham. And when they were going to Sham on this trip, there were various incidents that occurred. From amongst them was the meeting with the monk. The meeting with the monk, Bahira ibn Kathir, rahimahullahu ta'ala, mentions, وَخَرَجَ بِهِ عَمُّهُ إِلَى الشَّامِ فِي تِجَارَةِ, that his uncle Abu Talib took him to Sham on business. وَهُوَ ابْنُ ثْنَتَيْ عَشَرَ سَنَةً, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam at the time was 12 years old. وَذَلِكَ مِنْ تَمَامِ لُطْفِهِ بِهِ لِعَدَمِ مَنْ يَقُومُ بِهِ إِذَا تَرَكَهُ بِمَكَّةِ, and that was because of the great level of importance and kindness that Abu Talib had for his nephew Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He didn't want to leave him behind in Mecca, so he took him with him. And it's mentioned in the Sunan of At-Tirmidhi, various incidents that occurred on that trip, from amongst them, Tadlilil Ghamam Ahlahu, that the clouds would form above him to give him shadow from the sun, and Mailu Shajarati Bidhilliha Alayh, and that the trees would bend across to make the shadow upon him also. And then, of course, there was the meeting with the monk Bahira, and when they came across him, it was the monk who told them to return because he feared that the Jews would cause harm to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And those are mentioned in the Sunan of At-Tirmidhi and other places. Then the author mentions, وَسَارَ نَحْوَ الشَّامِ أَشْرَفُ الْوَرَى فِي عَامِ خَمْسَةٍ وَعِشْرِينَ ذْكُرَى لِأُمِّنَا خَدِيجَةٍ مُتَّجِرَى وَعَادَ فِيهِ رَابِحًا مُسْتَبْشِرًا فَكَانَ فِيهِ عِقْدُهُ عَلَيْهَا وَبَعْدَهُ إِفْضَاؤُهُ إِلَيْهَا. Now, it is mentioning another trip that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam made to Sham. And this was now when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was 25 years old. When he was 25 years old, he went on a business trip to Sham for Khadija radiyallahu anha. It was with the wealth of Khadija that he went to do business there, to Sham. وَكَانَتْ سَمِعَتْ عَنْهُ ذِكْرًا طَيِّبًا وَخُلُقًا فَاضِلًا وَأَمَانًا وَصِدْقًا وَوَفَاءً فَأَحَبَّتْ أَنْ تُتَاجِرَ بِمَالِهَا مَعَهُ. Khadija radiyallahu anha had heard that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was an upright, honest man, trustworthy, dignified, virtuous, fulfilling of his agreements and covenants. And so she desired that he be the one who take her wealth and do the business on her behalf in Sham. So she provided the wealth, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam went to do the business with the wealth of Khadija radiyallahu anha. And this was when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was now 25 years old. And remember, the revelation began when he was 40 years old, 40. So this was 15 years before the revelation began. So at the age of 25, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam headed towards Sham to do the business for Khadija radiyallahu anha, the trade for Khadija radiyallahu anha. Ibn Kathir mentions, ثُمَّ خَرَجَ ثَانِيًا إِلَى الشَّامِ فِي تِجَارَةٍ لِخَدِيجَةَ بِنْتِ خُوَيْلِدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا مَعَ غُلَامِهَا مَيْسَرَةً. That this was the second time now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam went to Sham, and this time it was to do business for Khadija, the daughter of Khuwaylid, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا. And also her servant Maysara went with him. فَرَأَى Maysara مَا بَهَرَهُ مِنْ شَأْنِهِ. And during that trip, Maysara, the servant of Khadija radiallahu anha, saw amazing things from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He saw amazing affairs from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam during that trip to Sham, during that business trip. So when they returned, Maysara went to Khadija radiallahu anha and he informed her of the amazing affairs that he had encountered and witnessed regarding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And so when she heard those affairs regarding him, she desired to marry the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And so that is what occurred. فَتَزَوَّجَهَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ وَلَهُ خَمْسٌ وَعِشْرُونَ سَنَةً. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married her, and he was 25 years old at the time, and she was at the time, كَانَ لَهَا رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا أَرْبَعُونَ سَنَةً. She was 40 years old at the time. Regarding that, there is some discussion amongst the scholars in the books of history, and some of them say, and they mention, that maybe Khadija radiallahu anha was actually 28 at the time. However, the correct position and the correct understanding, and what is most correct amongst the scholars, is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 25 and Khadija radiallahu anha was 40 at that time. That is the correct position regarding that. She was 40 years old at the time. وَلِأُمِّنَا خَدِيجَةَ بِاعْتِبَارَ أَنَّهَا صَارَتْ بَعْدُ زَوْجًا لِلنَّبِيِّ عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. So the author mentions Khadija as from the mothers, لِأُمِّنَا, and that is because the wives of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم are known as the أمهات. وَأَزْوَاجُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ, as Allah mentioned in the Quran, that his wives are their mothers, the mothers of the believers. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came back from that trip, and he came back profitable, he had made a profit from that trip and from that business with the money of Khadija radiallahu anha, the wealth of Khadija, he came back and he was glad, and that's when this marriage then occurred between Khadija radiallahu anha and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And she was the first wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he did not marry anybody else whilst he was married to Khadija radiallahu anha. لم يتزوج عليها غيرها حتى ماتت. He did not marry anyone else during his marriage to her until she died. Then after that, as it is known, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam married again. And regarding Khadija radiallahu anha, we know that she has many virtues. She has many virtues to the extent that the scholars, they discuss who has more virtues, Khadija radiallahu anha or Aisha radiallahu anha. And the scholars, they spoke about this, and there are discussions regarding this. And perhaps one of the best discussions is mentioned by Ibn al-Qayyim. He states that Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah also mentioned that the virtues of Khadija and the virtues of Aisha cannot be compared, because they are two different types of virtues. The virtues of Khadija radiallahu anha came in relation to the beginning of Islam, whereas the virtues of Aisha radiallahu anha, they came regarding or in relation to the end or the latter stages of Islam. So in the early stages of Islam or the early stages of the revelation, Khadija radiallahu anha, she was the support for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She is the one who provided him that support and that comfort in the early years. So her virtues are linked to those early years when the revelation began. Whereas Aisha radiallahu anha, her virtues are linked to the latter years, where she memorized a great deal of the sunnah from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And she was young, of course, when she married the Prophet. And so due to that young age, it was also a factor in her ability to memorize a great portion of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And she was one of the greatest narrators, meaning the most narrations from the companions, over 1,000 narrations from Aisha radiallahu anha. So their virtues are not really comparable side by side. Khadija has her virtues in one regard, And Aisha radiallahu anha has her virtues in another regard. And Aisha radiallahu anha mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to mention Khadija radiallahu anha, and that she would feel that type of jealousy regarding it that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would mention with such greatness, would mention with such emotion or of the stories and what he would say regarding Khadija radiallahu anha. And he would mention that his children were born from Khadija radiallahu anha. And that is where we come to next. Wa wulduhu minha khala Ibrahim fal awwalul qasimu hazat takrim. All of the children of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam were born from Khadija radiallahu anha, except for one. Khala Ibrahim, except for Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim was not born from Khadija. Ibrahim was born from Maria al-Qibtiyya. Maria al-Qibtiyya, she was the mother of Ibrahim. The first of the children, or from the first of the sons, al-awwal al-Qasim. Al-Qasim. And he was the one who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam took his kunya from, Abu al-Qasim. So al-Qasim was the first of the children of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he is the one that the kunya was taken from, Abu al-Qasim. And then he mentions, wa Zainabun ruqayyatun wa Fatima wa ummu kulthumin lahunna khatima. There was then Zainab and Ruqayya and Fatima and Kulthum. These are the four daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Zainab and Ruqayya and Fatima and Kulthum. And all of them were in the days of Islam. All of them were in the days of Islam. They were all Muslim. They all accepted Islam. They all made the hijrah with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Ibn Sa'd mentions in At-Tabaqat, the famous book of Ibn Sa'd, with his chain of narration to Ibn Abbas, قال كان أول من ولد لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بمكة قبل النبوة القاسم. That the first one to be born from the children of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in Mecca before the prophethood was Al-Qasim. Then ثم ولد له زينب. Then it was Zainab that was born. ثم رقية. Then Ruqayya, thumma Fatima, then Fatima, thumma Kulthum, and then Kulthum. Thumma wulida lahu fil Islami Abdullah. And then, during the days of Islam itself now, Abdullah was born. The son of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Abdullah. And he was the one that was known as At-Tayyib At-Tahir. At-Tayyib At-Tahir. And all of them, those six children, their mother was Khadija radiallahu anha. So the last of the daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the youngest of them, was Kulthum. And there is some difference between the scholars regarding that, but this is what some of them mentioned, that the final daughter, the youngest daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was Kulthum. Ibn Abd al-Barr mentioned in Al-Isti'ab, the book about the companions, وَالِاخْتِلَافُ فِي الصُّورَ مِنْ بَنَاتِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wasallam كثير. The differing between the scholars regarding who the youngest daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was is a lot. There is a differing between the scholars regarding that. But what seems to be the conclusion is that Zainab was the oldest of the daughters and that Ummu Kulthum was the youngest of the daughters. Ibn Hajar mentioned in Fath al-Bari, وَالْمُتَّفَقُ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَوْلَادِهِ مِنْهَا, that which is agreed upon from the children of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is Al-Qasim, and he in fact died at a young age even prior to the Prophet becoming a Prophet. And then he had the four daughters, Zainab, then Ruqayya, then Umm Kulthum, then Fatima. That's the order Ibn Hajar mentions. And he says, some of them have mentioned that Umm Kulthum was actually the youngest, younger than Fatima. There is one issue here regarding the son of the Prophet ﷺ, Abdullah. He was known as At-Tayyib, At-Tahir. And they were, as we say these days, like nicknames. They were other titles that he was given. And some of the scholars have said that actually At-Tahir and At-Tayyib, they were two other sons of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and that Abdullah is a separate son. This is an opinion of some of the scholars. But the overwhelming opinion and the correct opinion is that At-Tayyib and At-Tahir were just titles and names for Abdullah. They are all the same, Abdullah. It was not a different son called At-Tahir. It was not a different son called At-Tayyib. At-Tahir, At-Tayyib were names given to Abdullah also. So they were all in reference to Abdullah. وَالْكُلُّ فِي حَيَاتِهِ ذَاقُ الْحِمَامِ وَبَعْدَهُ فَاطِمَةٌ بِنِصْفِ عَامِ. All of the children of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam died during his lifetime, except Fatima. She died approximately 6 months after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So these are the tests and the trials that the scholars mention sometimes. That in and of itself is a great test, that one of your children dies. But rather, two of your children die. But rather, three of your children die. But four, but five. All of your children die. You witness all of their deaths except one. Certainly it would be a trial upon a person to lose a single child, and a greater trial to lose two children or three children. But consider that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam lost all of his children except one only, Fatima radiallahu anha, who died just 6 months after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. These are tests and trials. And that is why Allah mentioned, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ. The one who created الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ. Death and life to test you. This world is دَارُ الْإِبْتِلَى. It is an existence that is a test. And there are different types and forms of tests and trials that will come upon us. And the death of a beloved one is certainly from them, a test and a trial. And we are required to demonstrate our patience and demonstrate our trust and patience and reliance in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during those tests. So consider that the children of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they all passed away, they all died during his lifetime, except only one, who survived, and she died after his death by only a few months. And that's why he mentions wa ba'dahu Fatima binisfi amin, and after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Fatima died by 6 months. 6 months after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, his final daughter Fatima had also died and passed away. It is mentioned in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, Aisha radiallahu anha mentioned, أَنَّ فَاطِمَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا عَاشَتْ بَعْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ سِتَّةَ أَشْهُرٍ. That Fatima radiallahu anha lived after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam for 6 months. She lived only 6 months after that. So this mentions to us now regarding the children of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that is where we will conclude today's short session. As we've mentioned, we keep the sessions short every week, approximately half an hour only. There today, we've mentioned about the wife, Khadija radiallahu anha, the first wife, and the children of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Next week, we're going to begin with the topic and the story regarding the building of the Kaaba. When they built the Kaaba at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we know, of course, it was already built before that from Ibrahim alayhi salam, but then it had become somewhat broken and in ruin, and so they wished to rebuild the Kaaba. So next week, insha'Allah ta'ala, we'll begin with the story regarding how they rebuilt the Kaaba and the role of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam during that rebuilding of the Kaaba. So we'll conclude upon that for today then. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.